Stadt, which bears his name upon it as well as mine.
Und ich bin nun mit meiner Regierung zwei volle Tage, dessen habe gewartet, seit...
I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany.
What General Vagon has called the Battle of France is over. The Battle of Britain is about to begin.
Since I spoke to you last, not only have the Hun invaders been driven from the lands they had ravaged, but the guts of the German army have been largely torn out by Russian valor and generalship. The American victories in the Pacific, and in particular their latest conquest and liberation of the Marshall Islands, constitute superb examples of the combination of naval, air, and military force. When the signal is given, the whole circle of avenging nations will hurl themselves upon the foe and batter out the life of the cruelest tyranny which has ever sought to bar the progress of mankind.
It is the war in the Soviet Union which has battered the German army beyond hope of recovery. At the Battle of Kursk in July 1943, Hitler's last great gamble in the East ends in disaster. Hitler's intended battlefield at Kursk is of an area the size of England. Tens of thousands of Soviet civilians will transform it into a fortress, digging over 3,000 miles of trenches. Every mile along the front, the Red Army sights over 150 guns. The defensive line is 100 miles deep. The German armies at Kursk are almost 1 million strong, with over 2,500 tanks. Even so, Hitler admits, whenever I think of this attack, my stomach turns over. To German tank crews, the Battle of Kursk will become known as the Death Ride. By mid-August, Hitler's offensive is smashed utterly. The German armies have lost 50,000 men and 2,500 tanks. Nothing the German industry can do can make up for losses on such an enormous scale. As the might of the Red Army sweeps westward, the retreating Germans fight a bitter rearguard action. Demolition teams leave behind them an uninhabitable wasteland.
Declaration by President Roosevelt, Churchill, and Premier Stalin after last week's Tehran conferences is published this evening. Military and diplomatic staffs were there, and common policy for war and peace was shaped and confirmed. Complete agreement was reached on the scope and timing of operations to be undertaken from the east, west, and south, with common understanding as a guarantee of victory. The declaration also invites all nations dedicated to the elimination of tyranny and slavery into a world family of democratic nations.
The Tehran Conference of December 1943 leads to one vital agreement. The major effort of the Western Allies will not take place in Italy. Instead, the bulk of the Allied armies will be concentrated in Britain for an invasion of France. By the spring of 1944, 3 million fighting men have assembled in Britain for the coming invasion. Thousands of ships have disgorged over 5 million tons of American military equipment.
England has become one vast ordnance dump and field park. In every wood and copse, in leafy dead-end lanes and side roads, often in private gardens, under quarries and embankments, there it all was. Trucks, ambulances, tanks, armored cars, carriers, jeeps, bulldozers, ducks, vehicles of all kinds. Vast, really vast numbers of them. Right in the midst of it all, just as I turned for home, I passed a field where 22 men in khaki shirts and battle-dress trousers and heavy hobnail boots were having a quiet knock-up game of cricket. They made me think of Francis Drake and Plymouth Hoe.
Es steht eine Mühle im Schwarzwälder Tal, die klappert.
In France, German preparations are moving at a frantic pace. Thousands of soldiers and 250,000 conscripted civilian laborers build what Hitler has called his Atlantic Wall. But the overriding question for the German high command is where, along this enormous coastline, will the Allies choose to strike?
Da liegt mir die Mühle im Sinn.
Almost no intelligence can be gleaned from Britain. Since April, the British government has banned all coded radio transmissions. Diplomats are prevented from leaving the country. Even diplomatic bags are searched. All that German intelligence knows is what can hardly be concealed. The south of England is a gigantic armed camp.
Und in dieser Mühle, im Schwarzwälder Tal, da wohnet ein Mädel.
Field Marshal von Rundstedt, commanding the German defense, believes the invasion will come across the narrowest part of the channel, between Calais and Dieppe. Hitler's intuition tells him otherwise. The little intelligence available reports that a large-scale invasion exercise in Devon has chosen terrain closely matching the coast of Normandy. By now, the atmosphere in Britain is tense with expectation. Few think of anything but France and invasion. Even the news from Italy makes little impact. Yet there, 150,000 Allied soldiers are fighting a costly battle to draw as many German forces as possible away from France.
Thank you.
the beginning of 1944, the Allied advance in Italy has been blocked by powerful German defenses at the town of Cassino. By the middle of February, assaults by two American divisions have been beaten back with heavy losses. They have penetrated to within a few hundred yards of the town. Dominating Cassino is the Abbey of Monte Cassino. All over the world, concern for the fate of the 1,400-year-old monastery has been growing. American troops have reported that no German fire has ever come from the abbey itself. The Germans, to sway world opinion, have already moved its art treasures to Rome and presented them to the Vatican. It has been announced that no combat troops are to be stationed inside the monastery. On July the 15th, Allied commanders decide that the abbey is to be bombed. The bombing of Monte Cassino leaves behind a maze of undamaged cellars buried in mounds of rubble. The ruins are immediately occupied by the Germans. Their fire now dominates the area for miles around. It will be the following May before Monte Cassino is finally taken.
As for today's taking of the great abbey of Monte Cassino on Monastery Hill, this was an enormously hard-won triumph for Polish troops against an enemy from whom they had suffered much. In the mountain heights through which the Poles broke to get round the back of the ruined monastery fortress, fighting had been severe in the extreme. Men fought till they dropped exhausted, or dropped killed or wounded. They had to get through appalling mountain tracks, with the Germans commanding them and pouring streams of fire upon them at every move. The Poles were counterattacked time after time when they gained a height, and there was, all the time, no way up to the hill positions except by mule and finally on foot. Always the supply, ammunition and water parties had to go up through heavy German fire. In many positions, you could by day remain alive only in a hole in the ground. I was at the Polish headquarters on the morning of the capture when the news came through. We're in the abbey. Monastery Hill is occupied. The high wall of the abbey's west front was standing. Only that. The rest was just a pile of stones. That was all that remained of this famous religious house and seat of learning in this, the last act of its 1,400 years of history.
In the May of 1944, with D-Day fast approaching, the waters of the English Channel are alive with intense naval activity. Both sides are laying and clearing mines. Convoys shuttle between the Channel ports, carrying men and supplies for the operations to come. Chance encounters develop into running battles. The German High Command is still confused about Allied intentions. The scant information that German intelligence can gather is, as often as not, a deliberate deception. Operation Fortitude is designed to convince the Germans that the landings are to be made in the area of the Pas de Calais. A stream of fake radio messages is sent from a dummy headquarters on the English coast opposite the port of Calais. To complete the deception, for every reconnaissance mission flown over Normandy, two are flown over the Pas de Calais. Already the West Coast has been isolated from the rest of France by the bombing of bridges, rail links and roads. The German reinforcements, which will rush to meet the invaders, must be starved of supplies and denied mobility. Not an oil depot or an arms dump is to be left intact. Even canals are to be choked with sunken barges. Remnants of the German Air Force are compelled to choose between scrambling to meet the bomber fleets with their heavy fighter escorts or to be destroyed on the ground. The bulk of the German Air Force is still on the Eastern Front, fighting desperately to hold the Soviet advance. In the West, there is nothing to prevent the Allies winning complete mastery of the skies over France. For the German High Command, it is a dilemma to which there can be no solution. By June the 1st, embarkation leave is over for the soldiers of the Allied Expeditionary Force. Goodbyes had been said, and now hordes of Allied servicemen that have thronged the streets of London have simply disappeared. The invasion date has been set for June the 5th. On that day, both moon and tide will be in the Allies' favour. There must be the right conditions for airborne landings, a clear dawn for pinpoint bombing, a low tide so that sappers can clear obstacles and mines. Above all, there must be fine weather. The forecast is not good. With the men, weapons and equipment already loaded, the nightmare of Allied planners becomes a reality. A violent storm sweeps from the Atlantic to batter the Channel ports. Eisenhower, the Allied Supreme Commander, clearly understands that this may be the end of all their hopes. He tells his staff, the Nazis need nothing else to defend the coast but continued bad weather. If the invasion goes ahead on schedule, the landing grounds will be the scene of unimaginable chaos. On June the 5th, the experts predict that the following morning will see a brief break in the weather. Eisenhower is now faced with a momentous choice. A mistake could cost the lives of over 100,000 men, yet every day that passes will damage the morale of soldiers already keyed up to fever pitch. The decision is to go.
On the eve of this great adventure, I send my best wishes to every soldier in the Allied team. To us is given the honor of striking a blow for freedom which will live in history. And in the better days that lie ahead, men will speak with pride of our doings. We have a great and a righteous cause. Let us pray that the Lord, mighty in battle, will go forth with our armies, and that his special providence will aid us in the struggle. I want every soldier to know that I have complete confidence in the successful outcome of the operations that we are now about to begin. With stout hearts and with enthusiasm for the contest, let us go forward to victory.
By dawn of June the 6th, Operation Overlord has begun. The first waves of the airborne troops have already landed by night behind the German lines. Now the 150,000-strong 1st contingent of Montgomery's 21st Army Group is only hours from France. What lies ahead, no one can tell.
In the wardroom, dinner. From the menu, soup, roast beef and green peas, and apples and cream, it might have been across English Cherbourg in peacetime. And then you realized that your hand was moving just a little sluggishly to your mouth. Your tummy wasn't just where it usually was. The men around you were rather silent, and when they spoke, they were self-conscious. It was a room full of men on the way, wondering, waiting, and listening.
This is the BBC Home Service. Here is a special bulletin read by John Snagg. D-Day has come. Early this morning, the Allies began the assault on the northwestern face of Hitler's European fortress. The first official news came just after 9:30, when Supreme Headquarters of the Allied Expeditionary Force, usually called SHAPE from its initials, issued communique number one. This said, under the command of General Eisenhower, Allied naval forces supported by strong air forces began...
This is the day and this is the hour. The sky is lightning. Lightning over the coast of Europe as we go in. The sky is lighter and the sea is brighter, but along the shore there's a dense smoke screen as the battleships and the warships, the smaller warships, sweep along there, firing all the time against the shore and some of them laying a smoke screen for us. The sun is blazing down brightly now. It's almost like an omen, the way it suddenly come out just as we were going in. The whole sky is bright, the sea is a glittering mass of silver, with all these craft of every kind moving across it, and the great battleships in the background blazing away at the shore. There go the craft past us, the other landing craft. Some are left behind, the slower ones, each taking their part and going in at the right time for their right job. Destroyers, corvettes, patrol buses. I can hear the sound of anti-aircraft fire. I can't see yet whether it's our people who are being attacked. There's an enormous cloud of smoke along the shore, not only from the smoke screen, but from this terrific bombardment. All the ships are blazing away now. You can't imagine anything like this march of ships, like soldiers marching in line. I've never seen anything so expressive of intense... It's a purpose shared among many ships and among many hundreds of thousands of fighting men who are going in now to the coast of Europe to do the biggest job they've ever had to do. I can't record any more now because the time has come for me to get my kit on my back and get ready to step off on that shore. And it's a great day.
No one in the Allied invasion force doubts that the coming hours will determine the outcome of the entire battle. By now, the German Navy and Air Force are almost non-existent. But facing the Allies are 58 German divisions and an elaborate network of minefields, heavy coastal batteries, and underwater obstacles. Yet the armored counterattacks which the Allied commanders have been dreading will fail to materialize. Even as the invasion force fights its way onto the beaches of Normandy, the German High Command is divided on how best to deal with the threat. Precious hours are wasted in useless argument. It is late morning before Hitler, in his mountain retreat, even hears of the Allied invasion. Rommel, commanding 40 of the German divisions in the west, is in Germany for his wife's birthday. It is evening by the time he reaches his headquarters. Already the Allies have landed over 150,000 men for the loss of only 2,000. Any hope that they can be swept from the beaches is fading by the hour.
We're over the enemy coast now, and the run-in has started. 1 minute, 30 seconds, red light, green light, and out, out, get on, get out, get out. Out fast into the cool night. Out, out into the air over France. And we know that the dropping zone is obstructed. We're dropping, in fact, into fields covered with poles. But I hit my chute and lower my kit bag, which suspends on the end of a 40-foot rope from my harness. And then the ground comes up to hit me, and I find myself in the middle of a cornfield.
The paratroops are landing. They're landing all around me as I speak. They've come in from the sea, and they're fluttering down, red, white, and blue parachutes fluttering down, and they're just about the best thing that we've seen for a good many hours. They're showering in. There's no other word for it.
Ici Londres. Les Français parlent aux Français.
People of Western Europe. A landing was made this morning on the coast of France by troops of the Allied Expeditionary Force. This landing is part of the concerted United Nations plan for the liberation of Europe, made in conjunction with our great Russian allies. I have this message for all of you. Although the initial assault may not have been made in your own country, the hour of your liberation is approaching. All patriots, men and women, young and old, have a part to play in the achievement of final victory. To members of resistance movements, whether led by nationals or by outside leaders, I say, follow the instructions you have received. As Supreme Commander of the Allied Expeditionary Force, there is imposed on me the duty and responsibility of taking all measures necessary to the prosecution of the war. Prompt and willing obedience to the orders that I shall issue is essential. Effective civil administration of France must be provided by Frenchmen. All persons must continue in their present duties unless otherwise instructed. When France is liberated from her oppressors, you yourselves will choose your representatives and the government under which you wish to live. In the course of this campaign for the final defeat of the enemy, you may sustain further loss and damage. Tragic though they may be, they are part of the price of victory. I assure you that I shall do all in my power to mitigate your hardships. I know that I can count on your steadfastness now, no less than in the past. That the heroic deeds of Frenchmen who have continued the struggle against the Nazis and their Vichy satellites in France and throughout the French Empire have been an example and an inspiration to all of us. This landing is but the opening phase of the campaign in Western Europe. Great battles lie ahead. I call upon all who love freedom to stand with us now. Keep your faith staunch. Our arms are resolute. Together we shall achieve victory.
By June the 12th, the third wave of Allied divisions has landed in France. The expeditionary force now holds a strip of coastline 60 miles long and 12 miles deep. As the beachheads are expanded and linked together, each pushes further inland to join with growing numbers of airborne troops scattered behind German lines. By now, 326,000 Allied soldiers are fighting on French soil.
Thank you.
Faced with imminent disaster, Hitler refuses to allow his divisions to make an orderly withdrawal to new defensive positions. His field marshals protest, but their warnings are swept aside. A new secret weapon, Hitler believes, will turn the tide in Germany's favor. On June the 12th, thousands of Londoners hear strange sounds in the sky over the city. These are followed by astonishingly powerful explosions. The V1 behaves like nothing anyone has seen before. The effect is far more terrifying than a fleet of German bombers and almost as destructive. A single V1 carries almost a ton of high explosives. There is no beginning or end to a V1 raid. At least the German bomber fleets had eventually gone home, but now life is one long alert. Half of the 1,400 V1s launched in June are shot down over the sea or over open country, but the rest kill over 500 Londoners a week. Immediately, there are official moves to evacuate children and pregnant women, but few choose to leave for long. Everywhere, there is the conviction that with the Allies in France, the war will be over within months. Hitler's faith in the V1 has been utterly misplaced. Allied strength in Normandy is growing by the day, while the German generals are still under orders to hold the line that cannot be held. It is Allied mastery of the air that is crippling the German defense. Reinforcements attempting to move by day are at once pounced on by bombers and fighter bombers. Every Allied attack commences with air raids by up to 2,000 aircraft at a time.
Now, gray and purple smoke is billowing up from the Caen area. The results of this visual bombing attack are really terrific. Hundreds upon hundreds of pounds of bombs are raining down on this stricken town. And still the bombers come pouring in. There seems to be no end to them. This is an attack in a big way. The enemy is throwing up everything he has in the book, but he seems not able to get in any hits on our plane. Lots of near misses, but no telling shots. One bomber passing overhead has lost part of his tail assembly, although the pilot is lower than the other planes and his flight. He's keeping her straight and steady on a homeward course. The whole target area is a seething mass of smoke. In the growing darkness, I can see the first dull red outline of the fire that is apparently raging in Caen. It'll be a big bonfire soon, and you can look for those words, "big fires were left burning" in tomorrow's communique. Pilotless planes could never do a job like this, I'll bet. And now smoke is spreading over Caen, great clouds of it mushrooming upwards, and the flames are beginning to show an angry red color.
Within 5 weeks of D-Day, the city of Caen has been taken by the Allies. Cherbourg, too, has fallen after a fierce battle with a determined German garrison. At last, the Allies have possession of a major port. As the British and Canadians push out from the area of Caen, drawing heavy German forces to meet them, the Americans launch a new offensive. The aim of Operation Cobra is to break out from Normandy. The American Third Army, under General Patton, is spectacularly successful. Large German tank forces are encircled, and Patton's men drive headlong into the French interior. Eisenhower has already decided that in the drive through France, Paris is to be bypassed to save it from destruction. Hitler wishes to turn it into a fortress and hold it as a hostage. The issue will be decided by the people of Paris. August the 19th. With American forces approaching Paris, the National Council of Resistance gives its partisans the order for insurrection. For 4 days, street battles rage throughout the city. The French leaders are determined that the capital will be liberated by its own citizens. On August the 23rd, after a bitter struggle, resistance forces succeed in freeing the greater part of Paris. The following day, fighting flares up once more as the Germans make a final effort to crush the rebellion. To the south of the city, French troops fighting with the American 5th Corps are closing in. The 4th French Armored Division, with American support, has already penetrated the suburbs. 2 days later, Charles de Gaulle enters the French capital.
Here is the news, read by Richard West. Paris has been liberated. A communique just received from General Koenig announces that it has been liberated by French forces of the interior.
It's been one of the most marvelous sights I've ever seen, coming down the boulevard into the heart of Paris. Everywhere we went, people came running out of their houses, out of the shops, shaking hands with us. Children were held up to us to be kissed, and they clung around our necks. People were giving us flowers, tomatoes, everything. It's been the most marvelous procession I've ever seen. Here they are, they're just mad with joy. Just listen to these crowds. Now turned to face the square in this huge crowd of Parisians. He's being presented to people. He's being received. He's being received. Even while the general is marching, into the cathedral, well, that was one of the most dramatic scenes I've ever seen. Just as General de Gaulle was about to enter the Cathedral of Notre Dame, firing started all over the place. I'm afraid we couldn't get you the noise of that firing because I was overwhelmed by a rush of people who were trying to seek shelter and my cable parted from my microphone. But I fell just near General de Gaulle and I managed to pick myself up. General de Gaulle was trying to control the crowds rushing into the cathedral. He walked straight ahead into what appeared to me to be a hail of fire from somewhere inside the cathedral, somewhere from the galleries up near the vaulted roof. But he went straight ahead without hesitation, his shoulders flung back, and walked right down the central aisle, even while the bullets were pouring around him.
Wir wollen glücklich sein.
The failure of the V1 has done little to undermine Hitler's faith in secret weapons as a salvation of Germany. Now he pins his hopes on the V2. By September 1944, 900 V2s a month are being produced in an underground factory in the Harz Mountains. The V1 had depended on fixed launch platforms, easily destroyed by bombing. The mobile V2 can be launched from any open space, and the firing site can be evacuated within minutes. On September the 6th, 11 days after the liberation of Paris, Hitler orders two V2 rockets to be fired at the city. Both explode in flight without reaching their target. 2 days later, the V2 is turned on England. The British government already knows the full technical details of the V2. 4 months earlier, on May the 20th, a V2 rocket on a test flight has crashed on the Polish countryside, 80 miles from Warsaw. Before the Germans can reach it, it is dismantled by Polish resistance fighters and hidden. 5 days later, it is transported by cargo plane from Poland to London. The British government has a V2 in its possession 7 weeks before the first raids on Britain. The first that the people of London know of the V2 is a series of massive explosions all over the city. Government officials announce the explosions are due to gas mains. The announcement fools no one. Over 1,000 V2s are fired at London. Over 500 reach their target, killing 2,700 people. The knowledge for which Polish resistance fighters have risked their lives fails to lead to any effective defense. Only the overrunning of Germany will end the menace of the V2.
I want today, the 17th of September, to speak to all soldiers in the group of armies under my command. What a change has come over the scene since I last spoke to you on the 21st of August. The Allies have removed the enemy from practically the whole of France and Belgium, except in a few places, and we stand at the door of Germany.
The optimism of the Allies will soon suffer a brutal shock. On December the 16th, the Germans launch a great counter-offensive in the Ardennes. If a route can be opened to the Belgian city of Antwerp, the Allied armies will be split in two. The Battle of the Bulge is Hitler's last great gamble. German assault with 24 divisions achieves almost complete surprise. Allied intelligence has failed completely to interpret the signs, and bad weather has grounded the Allied air forces. On the ground, specially trained German troops speaking American English and wearing GI uniforms spread suspicion and confusion. After the initial gains, fate turns against the German offensive. The weather clears, and Allied air forces can once more dominate the skies. By December the 24th, the German offensive is broken. On Christmas Day, the Allies launch their counter-offensive. Now it is only a matter of time before the Allied armies fight on German soil.
Hello, BBC. This is Ian Wilson speaking from Supreme Headquarters. The Americans are over the Rhine. Supreme Headquarters announced a few minutes ago that General Hodges' 1st United States Army has crossed the Rhine. Elements reached the Rhine and crossed to establish a bridgehead on the east bank somewhere south of Cologne.
BBC, this is Stuart McPherson reporting from Germany. One has only to spend a few minutes among our advancing troops on the far side of the Rhine to feel the almost frenzied spirit of offense that is running through every single formation. This morning I went across one of the Rhine bridges, and all along the route I was staggered by the hustle and dash of every single formation, right down from the military police to squadron commanders who were racing tanks across the river and far beyond on the other side. Up to the time of the Rhine push, it had always been a good idea to slow down when approaching a bridge, for that was the direction that was glaring at you in bold red letters off a snow-white signboard. But no more. Things have changed. I had hardly put the nose of the car down towards the start of the bridge when an English policeman bellowed, "Come on, mate, flat out across that bridge."
This chase after the Germans flying in confusion from the banks of the Rhine has been one of the strangest experiences of the war. Our tanks have long ago left the torn and shattered landscape around Wesel and Xanten, where we first forced the crossing. They are now out in undamaged country, racing through villages which have never seen war. And it's the strangest possible sensation to be driving almost at will, utterly unmolested, through the heart of your enemy's country. It just doesn't seem possible, and yet, somehow, here we are.
The Allied crossing of the Rhine in March 1945 marked the final phase of the war in Europe. The Western Front is still held by 70 German divisions fighting stubbornly for every inch of their homeland. Against the 170 German divisions in the east, the Soviet Union has launched a new offensive on a colossal scale. Along a 300-mile front, there are 2 million men. Every mile, there are 100 guns and 20 tanks. By February, the Red Army is within 40 miles of Berlin. By April, the German capital is encircled.
East and West have met. At 20 minutes to 5 on Wednesday afternoon, April the 25th, 1945, American troops of General Bradley's 12th Army Group made contact with Soviet elements of Marshal Konev's 1st Ukrainian Army Group near the German town of Torgau on the Elbe. This is the news for which the whole Allied world has been waiting. Nazi Germany, tottering to her final collapse, has been split clean in half.
Now, in this, the most serious time of our modern age, I beg you to realize that the fight is on. I would only say that the men who have died in the Battle of Berlin have given their lives to show that whatever else happens, Germany will live. No coercion, no oppression, no measures of tyranny that any foreign foe can introduce will shatter Germany. Germany will live because the people of Germany have in them the secret of life, endurance, will, and purpose. And therefore I say to you, in these last words, you may not hear from me again for a few months. I say, es lebe Deutschland, Heil Hitler, and farewell.
the end of April, the Red Army is fighting in the streets of Berlin. The defenders of the city are under direct orders from Hitler to fight to the bitter end. The third largest city in the world is to be the last battleground of the Third Reich. By June the 30th, the Red Army units have advanced to within less than a mile of Hitler's bunker headquarters.
This is London calling. Here is a news flash. The German radio has just announced that Hitler is dead. I repeat that. The German radio has just announced that Hitler is dead.
Hitler's order to fight on, when all hope had long since vanished, has cost almost 1 million lives. In the battle for Berlin, 93 German divisions have been destroyed in 18 days. The Red Army has lost 305,000 dead, wounded, or missing. 125,000 German civilians have been killed in the battle. Another 6,000 have committed suicide.
Berlin has practically ceased to exist. The RAF and the Americans by air and the Russians by land have wiped the place out. It is true that other cities, German and Allied, have also been wiped out. But this is Berlin, a huge city of many millions, the capital of a nation which only recently claimed a population of 80 million. It's the scale of the thing that is so terribly, terribly in the true sense of the word, so terribly impressing and depressing. For, as Air Chief Marshal Tedder himself so rightly said to me yesterday, it's impossible to gloat over this sort of thing. But the job had to be done. Anyhow, there it is, mile upon mile of unending ruin, devastation, and, as the cleared rubble will one day prove, of death. How many people perished in the bombing and fighting will probably never be known. But it must run into many, many thousands. And what about those who remain, you may ask? Well, the Russians estimate that there are still probably about 2 million people in the capital, most of them living in the cellars that have served them so well. Many of the people I saw on the streets were trundling prams or other wheel contrivances crammed with their remaining portable possessions. Others trudged along with bundles in their hands or on their shoulders. Not a few that I saw were sitting vacantly amid the ruins, too tired or too apathetic to look for shelter. Most are old men and women or children, with here and there younger but obviously unfit men. The rest of the young men had been scooped up as cannon fodder, and now they lie in their graves or a bed in hospital or are behind barbed wire.
This is the BBC Home Service. We're interrupting programs to make the following announcement. It is understood that in accordance with arrangements between the three great powers, an official announcement will be broadcast by the Prime Minister at 3 o'clock tomorrow, Tuesday afternoon, the 8th of May.
Yesterday morning at 2:41 a.m. at General Eisenhower's headquarters, General Jodl, the representative of the German High Command, and of Grand Admiral Dönitz, the designated head of the German state, signed the act of unconditional surrender of all German land, sea, and air forces in Europe to the Allied Expeditionary Force, and simultaneously to the Soviet High Command. We may allow ourselves a brief period of rejoicing.